Namaste everyone. I, Purva, a student of IIT Madras,
convey my special welcome to our chief guest, Professor Makarand Paranjape, and distinguished guest on behalf of my Vande Mataram family to our third annual Shri Bankim Chandra Chattopadhyaya Memorial Lecture. IIT Madras emerged as the number one institute in India in overall category and number one in engineering for the fourth consecutive year. We have also ranked number one in Atal Innovation Rankings. We take this opportunity to congratulate students, research scholars, faculties, non-teaching staffs, alumni and all people for making IIT Madras get to the top honors in NIRF ranking and Atal rankings on Innovation 2019. We will continue to excel in all spheres and make sure that we will lead the world one day. In the year 2017, we started an annual lecture series named Shri Bankim Chandra Chattopadhyaya Memorial Lecture. Every year, we will arrange this memorial lecture in the month of April. The first lecture was delivered by Dr. Anirvan Ganguly on Articulating Bharat, presenting Bharat on a global stage on 8th of April 2017. The second lecture was delivered by Professor Michael Denino. Title is India a Secular Nation, an Unvarnished Look at India's Many Brands of Secularism on 23rd April 2018. Today, we are arranging third annual Shri Bankim Chandra Chattopadhyaya Memorial Today we are arranging third annual Shri Bankim Chandra Chattopadhyaya Memorial Lecture Series titled Nation as Goddess, Bhavani, Bharati and Her Matriots. Now I request our chief guest, Professor Makarand Paranjape ji, faculty advisor Professor Ramashankar Verma ji, and other faculties and our volunteers to come forward to offer the floral tribute to Shri Bankim Chandra Chattopadhyaya. Vande Mataram, our national song written by Shri Bankim Chandra Chattopadhyaya, has played a pivotal role in the Indian independence movement. An ode to the mother goddess, as it was written in the novel Anandamath, was a homage to the mother and motherland. Our Vande Mataram family is an independent student body of IIT Madras, and we endeavor to conduct events to sensitize the student community and keep them abreast of India's rich cultural, economic, socio-political, scientific and technological heritage and its relevance today. We aspire to develop our student contemporary issues and thoughts about the roadmap ahead. Shloka from Ramayana, Janani Janmabhumischa Swargadapi Garyasi, which means the lap of our mother and motherland is greater than any joy of heaven, is the philosophy which has kept us going ahead in the last 4 years in this institute and strengthens our national consciousness. We have been proudly following the tradition of singing the national song Vande Mataram at the very beginning, and I would request you all to stand up at your place to sing the national song. Before we begin, please switch off all your cell phones or put it on silent mode. I request Srinivas ji to come to dais and to lead.
Vande Mataram, Vande Mataram, Sujalam Suphalam, Malayaj Sheetalam, Shasya Shyamalam Mataram, Vande Mataram, Shubhrajyotsnam Pulakitayaminim, Phullakusumita Drumadala Shobhinim, Suhasinim Sumadhurabhashinim, Sukhadam Varadam Mataram, Vande Mataram. Koti koti kantha kalakala ninada karale, koti koti bhujair dhrithakara karavale, abalakyanu mayat bole, bahubaladharinim namamitarinim, Ripudhalavarini Mataram, Vande Mataram. Tumi Vidya, Tumi Dharma, Tumi Hridi, Tumi Marma. Tvam hi prana sharire, bahute tumi ma shakti, hridaye tumi ma bhakti, tomare pratima gadi mandire, mandire mataram, vande mataram. Tvam hi Durga dasha praharana dharini kamala kamala dala viharini vani vidyadayini namami tvam namami kamala mamalam atulam Sujalam Suphalam Mataram Vande Mataram Shyamalam Saralam Susmitam Bhushitam Dharanim Bharanim Mataram Vande Mataram, Vande Mataram.
Thank you, Srinivasji. We are privileged to have our chief guest, Professor Makarand Paranjape Ji, with us today. Professor Paranjape is currently the director of Indian Institute of Advanced Studies, Shimla. He was educated at St. Stephen's College, Delhi, and the University of Illinois at Urbana-Champaign, where he earned a master's and doctoral degree in English. He has been professor of English at Jawaharlal Nehru University for 18 of his 38 years as university teacher. He is the author of some 20 books and editor of over 24 books, in addition to the hundreds of academic papers and popular articles. His latest book, including Debating the Post Condition in India, Cultural Politics in Modern India, and the Death and Afterlife of Mahatma Gandhi. Today, Professor Paranjape will deliver his much anticipated lecture on the subject Nation as Goddess, Bhavani Bharati and her Matriots. This lecture aims to explore an intriguing and unique facet of Indian nationalism, the idea of India as Bharata Shakti, and it will help us unlock how the nation came to become conceived, construed, and conceptualized as Bhavani Bharati and worshipped as a goddess. Now I invite Professor Makarand Paranjape to the stage, and I also invite Professor Mahavir Jain from the Department of Physics to welcome our chief guest with a fruit basket.
Other respected professors of IIT, my dear friends from the Vande Mataram group, I'm really honored and delighted to be here to deliver the third Bankim Chandra Chattopadhyaya or Chattopadhyaya Memorial Lecture. My previous two speakers, my predecessors, are friends as well as extremely distinguished academicians and intellectuals in their own right. I want to remember them both, Michelle Danino, as well as Anirban Ganguly. And I feel extremely privileged to be in that tradition, and even more privileged that we are here today to remember, celebrate, commemorate Bankim Chandra Chattopadhyaya, who was such an extraordinary figure in the intellectual history of modern India. Let me start with an anecdote about Bankim Chandra Chattopadhyaya. In those days, after he had written Anandamath, which was written in about 1882, it was serialized in a journal. And as you know, we sang, some of us at least who know the word, sang all of Vande Mataram. Others sang the first couple of stanzas. There's a whole story around that. if we get time, we'll talk about that. But he wrote Vande Mataram as a standalone hymn in 1876, and then he wrote Anandamath, and he incorporated the song into the novel. Okay. In those days there used to be a very unusual kind of darbar held in Dakshineshwar on the banks of the Ganga, where Sri Ramakrishna met all kinds of people, and sometimes he also met some of these leading figures of the period in the houses of various devotees and well-wishers of his in Kolkata. So one day Bankim also came there, and Adhar, one of his devotees, introduced him, saying that he's a great scholar, a leading intellectual of Bengal, and a great writer. And so Sri Ramakrishna asked him, "Bankim, why are you, crooked? Because why are you bent out of shape? Because Bankim means crooked, as you know, right? And it's also, like Bake, Bankim. Banke is also a name of Krishna, as you know. If you go to Vrindavan, there's a temple, Banke Bihari. So he asks Bankim, "Why are you so bent?" So he said, "I have been bent out of shape because of the kicks that I have received from the English." Unki lato se, the kicks that the boots, the well-booted, if not the well-suited and booted, British rulers kick me around so much that I'm bent out of shape. This makes you think, that Bankim was an extraordinary figure. He was one of the first graduates of the Calcutta University, which, as you know, was founded the same year as the Great Revolt, 1857. And if you go to Presidency College, you can still see his mark sheet. He was one of the first four graduates of Calcutta University. And he was immediately hired by the British East India Company, which of course later became the British Raj, because Queen Victoria took over India. Direct administration, it came under the crown. He started as a deputy magistrate and he ended his career as a deputy magistrate. He never got promoted. He was always in trouble with the authorities because he was a deeply, you might say, nationalistic figure, critical of imperialism, and at the same time a bit of a modernizer. He wanted to understand the modern world as well. And this text of his, Anandamath, during his own lifetime, during the time of his career, went through five editions, and in each edition he made changes, so that he wasn't in trouble with the authorities. So there's an established critique of Bankim as well as Anandamath as an anti-Muslim and a communal text. But some of the finest leftist intellectuals, including Tanika Sarkar, have argued against this simplistic and reductive view. You can read this article in EPW. But essentially, there is a lot of juggling going on in the text, where you can't directly criticize the British, and where the rulers against whom the sannyasis are revolting actually stand for the British, but are shown to be the current Nawabi rulers. But Anandamath was written at a very interesting time, and it reflected 100 years prior to that time, a period of great famine in Bengal, when Warren Hastings just took over the administration of Bengal. And in fact, they took over the Diwani. Diwani was the tax collection. So actually Bengal was under two authorities, right? The taxes were collected by the British, and the titular political power still was with the British. So you can see that it's a sort of complex and double-edged critique of the abuse of power in Bengal in the 1770s, which led to the wiping out of about a third of Bengal. So the signature of British imperialism was famine. They started with wiping out millions of people in Bengal people died of starvation. So I was at another place recently and we were talking about the Jallianwala Bagh, and according to the official figures, the Indian and unofficial figures are higher, of course, but the official figures are about 369 people were killed, right? When the Gurkhas and other, Baluchi and other troops opened fire because of Reginald Dyer's orders. And it's such a hugely, commemorated event, 369. I'm not saying that, numbers are what matter. I'm not saying that. But please remember that 369 people were killed at Jallianwala, but millions perished in famines in Bengal. Millions, in fact. If we have time, I'll show you some photographs of the famine of Bengal. It was quite well documented in 1942-43. So they started with a famine and they ended with a famine. That was their signature. That's why I call it the signature of empire. And conservative estimates are over 27 million people perished under that period, 150 years of British rule. If you start in 1770 and end in 1947, about a little over 150 years, about 30 million people died of starvation in India. And so, as I said, I'm very privileged today to remember Bankim, who was an outstanding thinker of his time and quite forgotten today, except Vande Mataram, which we still remember. There's so much of his works to read. And the only person in the 20th century who understood the importance of Bankim was Sri Aurobindo, who called him Rishi Bankim. So in the first decade of the 20th century, Sri Aurobindo writes this amazing essay. There are three pieces in that little booklet called Rishi Bankim, which I invite you to read. Which brings us to the quotations that you saw earlier on. Now, should I speak louder, sir? Then? Okay. But there's a hum, So I can always speak louder. I know I'm a teacher, so I can throw my voice to the back row. If you're hitting the back row, then you succeeded. Otherwise, there's no point just speaking to the front row, right? So you're going to be my ideal audience, whoever you are. Thank you, sir. And raise your hand if you can't hear what I'm saying. So, I'm saying that this is a very good segue from Bankim to Sri Aurobindo, because the title of my talk, Bhavani Bharati, is taken from Bankim, is taken not from Bankim, but from Sri Aurobindo. And it's a poem attributed to Sri Aurobindo. We don't know exactly when it was written. They say it was written between 1904 and 1910. It's an unsigned Sanskrit poem in 99 stanzas. Which even the Sri Aurobindo Ashram believes that it was written by Sri Aurobindo. It was his only composition in the Sanskrit language. So if you believe, his editors working in the ashram, then it's a poem written by him. I'm not 100% sure of it. And there's an online translation of this easily available by Richard Hartz, who is an American who's lived in the ashram for a very long time and is a great Sanskritist in his own right. So the stanzas that I read out to you, or rather were in the poster, people might have wondered, where is that stanza from? It's a little bit of a quiz. So if you're quizzers, then you would have found out that it's from this amazing poem, Bhavani Bharati, attributed to Sri Aurobindo. And I think it's stanza number 31 that I've quoted there, where he says, "Summon forth to battle the ancient tribes of the Bharatas. Let there be victory, fear not, lo, I have awakened. Where is the bow? Where is the bow? Where the sword? Arise, arise, O sleeping lions." Talk to each other. Which two texts? Vande Mataram by Bankim and Bhavani Bharati by Sri Aurobindo. And this poem in 99 stanzas has a very interesting plot. It starts with the poet, you know, basically sleeping on a nice couch and has a very pleasant, pleasure-filled life. And he has a dream. And in the dream, he sees the form of the goddess as Mother India or as Bhavani Bharati, waking him up and saying, how are you enjoying all the sensual pleasures when I am so oppressed? And then the poem goes on, there's a dramatic clash with a titan, or like a titan is Sri Aurobindo's word for an asura, who's this huge creature, you know. And that obviously stands for British imperialism, which is crushing all the nations underfoot. And then there is this battle between the two, which the poet witnesses. And of course, the mother goddess is triumphant. And so it becomes a new myth superimposed on the old story of Durga, the mother goddess who annihilates Mahishasura, right? This asura. So the British government there is seen or depicted like Mahishasura, which the goddess arises to annihilate. And this poem was confiscated among the different papers which were found in order to indict Sri Aurobindo. He spent a year in jail, in Alipur jail. Good. So now this brings us to the main question which I am trying to explore in this talk, which is, how is it that the nation came to be conceptualized, imaged, and imagined as a goddess? Okay? So, what are the goddess making mechanisms that this particular civilization has at its disposal, which were harnessed into the creation of this entity? And what is the yearning that produces this form, which I'm going to show you, many, many forms I'm going to show you. So what is the yearning that produces the form? And then you may also ask, what does the form demand? You see what I'm trying to get at, okay? And here is Sri Aurobindo writing in another very important text around the same time, 1906, when he's still in Baroda. He hasn't moved to Bengal. He's going to go there as the principal of the National College, which of course now is a great leftist bastion, Jadavpur University. So these are the ironies of history. He wrote another amazing unsigned text called Bhavani Mandir, which again goes back to Bankim, because Bankim in Anandamath gives you that vision of the, you know, deserted temple in the middle of the forest where the santans or the children of the mother worship the three figures, you see, Jagadatri, that is the goddess as nation as she was, then Kali, completely emaciated, right, skull, necklace around, you know, her neck, and all the starving children of hers, and in a terrible shape, a horrific, terrific, you know, frightful form. And then the goddess, as she's going to be resplendent again in the times to come, in the post-colonial period to come, as Durga, right? So from there, there's a direct link to Bhavani Mandir of Sri Aurobindo, which was a revolutionary pamphlet where you might think of it superficially as creating temples everywhere. But Bhavani Mandir was actually a template for a honeycomb of secret revolutionary organizations to overthrow the British. It's another matter that, in a sense, it failed to take off, whether it was Anushilan Samiti or the other, you know, secret, so to speak, you know, terrorist, as they were labeled by the British organizations. Most of these were young, middle-class Bengalis who were sent off to Kalapani. So these are the texts which are all interconnected with this idea of the nation as goddess, which we want to explore. So I'll read you a couple of more quotes, and then we'll see a lot of these pictures. For what is a nation? What is our mother country? Asks Sri Aurobindo. It is not a piece of earth, nor a figure of speech, nor a fiction of the mind. It is a mighty Shakti composed of the Shaktis of all the millions of units that make up the nation, just as Bhavani Mahisha Mardini, Mahishasur Mardini sprang into being from the Shakti of all the millions of gods assembled in one mass of force and welded into unity. The Shakti we call India, Bhavani Bharati, is the living unity of the Shaktis of 300 million people, right? And if you look at that period in Shurabindo's life, it's fairly well documented in Ambalal Purani's accounts or in Nirodh Baran's accounts of Shurabindo. Apparently, Shurabindo actually had a dream where he saw a vision of Shurabindo who says, Mandir Gado. And that's Gadi, Tumari Pratima Gade. That's that word in Vande Mataram that you heard singing. You heard sung and you sang, I suppose. So you can see how these texts are all interconnected. Okay. And the other word that I've used in my talk, the title of my talk is Matriots. So my argument is we are not a nation of patriots. And it's not patriotism that we should be exploring, but matriotism, and we are matriots. So we must try to please understand the notion of matriots, okay? Now, this word, matriot, was actually used for the first time by James Russell Lowell. Like patriotism, but it meant some sort of a school, a hometown, a parish loyalty as opposed to nationalism. So it was very local. To be a matriot was to be a very local, kind of ideology. But it also meant the celebration of women's influence on society, the female equivalent of patriotism, which is what I'm trying to argue. And also the love of the motherland, okay? So what happens when we are matriots as opposed to patriots? That's something that I want you to think of. And then we can also talk a little more about it. More recently, in 2006, Cindy Sheehan wrote an article to President Bush called Matriotism, where she says matriotism is a form of pacifism, okay? So if you're patriots, you'll go and bomb Iraq and all. But if you're matriots, you'll be very non-violent. I don't think that fully applies to, the Bankim and the Shurabindo version of matriotism. Okay. Now I put the cover of a very interesting book here for you, "The Goddess and the Nation: Mapping Mother India" by Sumati Ramaswamy. She teaches at Duke University. It's a very fine book. If for nothing else, for the 150 pictures she's collected, okay? So take a look at it. Perhaps it's in your library. It's really worth reading. And she makes a very complicated argument there, which I'm going to try to simplify, which is that she says that modernity and imperialism was a triumph of cartography, okay? In that sense, it's very appropriate we're having this talk at IIT Madras, the number one institution in India, where we celebrate science and technology, because the triumph of modernity is the triumph of science and technology in some sense. So the imperial powers were obsessed with maps, and they mapped the world precisely so that they could rule it, so that they could conquer it. And if you really do a comparative cartographic study, you'll find that the other nations of the world were very far behind. They had mythical mappings, not more precise mappings that the British had. Though in the trigonometric survey of India, Indians played a very important role. So that's a different matter. But the argument in Sumati Ramaswamy's book is that the geobody of Mother India was an emotive and symbolic construct to counter the cartographic imagination of the empire. So you see, it's a clash of the imperial, dominating technology, mapping the world, then surveying it, and then exploiting it. And to counter it, Indians created this, what she calls the geo body of the nation, you know, which was an emotive construct, you know. But according to her, you know, there are, like, you might differ on this topic. There's a debate as to whether Mother India is a completely new invention, okay, in the late 19th century, or it's a very old idea, okay. We can debate this and discuss this, but Ramaswamy thinks it's very new. The reason she says that is, though there were many goddesses in India, and there was a process, she doesn't say that, but we know that we created goddesses. So, you know, it's not that the gods or the god creates us, but we create the gods, okay. We have a process here that we can give rise to new deities. So if there's smallpox, you can create a new goddess, Shitalama or Mariamman, and you can create another new goddess, Santoshima, which doesn't exist about 500 years ago, for example. So, and today you may even want to invoke Parking Devi, Examination Devi, right? Other kinds of devis, Tax Devi. So you do have the capacity to create gods and goddesses. But there was no goddess as nation before the 19th century, according to Sumati Ramaswamy. And why? What is the evidence? Because this is one goddess which requires a map. See, every god or goddess has certain associations. There is a Vahana, she's a Simha Vahini, so she's like Durga, right? Then what are her sometimes she has a trident, sometimes she has a sword, like the Tulja Bhavani, right? But she always is associated with a map. And the point that Sumati Ramaswamy is making, that map was not available before the British created an accurate cartography of India. Are you getting the argument? So it cannot be an old goddess, because we didn't have the map on which she superimposed. The map was British. We superimpose the goddess on the map to create a counter-narrative to the narrative of imperialism, right? With its armament, its armature is technology, science, and so forth. And we said, no, this is not a piece of earth. It's not, you know, it's not inert, but it's a Shakti. It's full of power, and it is, I'm glad that we have some technical glitches even at IIT, right? It humanizes us, you know. Imperfection humanizes us, okay? Perfection only belongs to the non-human world, whether it's the world of robotics or artificial intelligence. Human beings are deeply flawed, and that's what makes us who we are. I'm going to show you a wonderful picture of the Jain cosmology, where you'll see the middle area is where human beings take birth. It's also the great Tirthankars take birth there in that area, because you can progress there. And the worlds of the gods are worlds of bliss, and the Narkas are below. I'll show you those pictures. But just to finish the argument, so there are two ways of looking at this idea of, you know, nation as goddess. One is that it's a very old idea. The other is that it is an invention in the 19th century. I have my own views on it. If I have time, I will explain them to you. But one thing is clear, that the idea of Bharat Mata or Bhavani Bharati or goddess as nation suddenly takes off in the 19th century, around 1870s, after 1860. And there's also a wonderful play called Bharat Mata, okay, where again there is a discovery in the forest, and patriots are roused to fight for the mother, okay. And those ideas were picked up by Bankim, as I'm saying, then later picked up by other people. So that is the story, okay, which we are trying to tell here, the story of the nation as goddess. I want to just talk about one more methodological thing, and then we can see the pictures. And that is, how do the visual, this is the visual history of India, which I'm going to show you, and the scriptural, or the written, see, the written texts have greater authority because the visual archive is very messy. It's full of bazaar art, you know, calendar art. A lot of people come up with images. They circulate in a non-elite medium. How do they intertwine? Now, some people say that the gaps in the scriptural or the textual history, the dominant history, the gaps can be filled in by the pictures. And I think I disagree, because it's not a matter of supplementary histories or complementary histories, but it's a very complex intertwining. Now, one of the critics, a theoretician who talks about this, W.J.T. Mitchell, says, what do pictures want? As I asked you, what do we want from pictures? But what do pictures want? And he says, his article is called The Lives and Loves of Images. I like that title, right? And he says, and this is very easy for us to understand in India. He says, we should imagine pictures as animated beings with desires, needs, appetites, demands, and drives of their own. This is exactly how we consider our images and idols, right? They have to be woken up, they have to be fed, they have to be entertained, there's a dance for them, music. So he's saying pictures have a life. That's what he's saying. And then he says, the question to ask is not just what they mean or do, but what they want. What claim they make upon us, and how are we to respond? And so he's saying, what pictures want from us, what we have failed to give them, is an idea of visuality adequate to their ontology. Pictures want equal rights with language, not to be turned into language. I think that is so profound. Pictures don't want to be turned into language, right? They want equal rights with language. So just think about it. In cultures which are picture phobic, what do? You deprive yourself of this rich archive of another language. You can't reduce everything to words, okay? And there's a beautiful reference in the life of Rabindranath, where even after he's won the Nobel Prize and the First World War ends, there's an exhaustion of words. And he takes to painting. And he says he wants to break free from the khyati prangan of words. You know, that you might say the threshold of fame that words have given him, to evolve another language. And his pictures are so dark, you know. Everybody tried to paint Mother India, okay? I'll show you some. Amrita Shergill, M.F. Hussain, I'll show you some pictures, okay? So I think this is how we have to look at these two different archives, you know, and the stories they tell. So if you look at only the textual histories of India, especially those written by a particular regime, you know, you will get a very different picture from what you get from the visual archive, where characters like Netaji, Bhagat Singh, and so on are as important as other figures, you know, like Nehru and Gandhi. So pictures tell a very different story from the official or unofficial elite histories which are scriptural and textual, okay? So let's think about, equal rights for pictures and icons. And that's why I like what Mitchell says. Mitchell says, how do you read pictures? He says, what is required is a critical idolatry. So since we're all idolatrous, most of us, that is, right? Instead of reflexive, critical iconoclasm. Please see, it's such a beautiful statement. So, modern, secular, humanities and social science discourse is critically iconoclastic. And Mitchell is saying we need critical idolatry. I don't know if I'm making sense, okay? Good. So here is what we have. Bharat Mata is a novel and unorthodox goddess because she needs the outline map of India to set her apart from other deities. So this is the point that Sumati Ramaswamy makes. And as I said, there is the counter argument. This is the argument of a territorial and cultural nationalism versus a vestigial Shaktism, okay? The vestigial Shaktism, which is an argument that I'm also going to make. And then before ending, I want us to also refer, as we go through this, to the work of two other very interesting writers. One is, of course, Tagore and his great text, Ghore Baire, or Home in the World, where Damila is pictured or is invoked as Mother Bengal, okay, by Sandeep. But Sandeep is a demagogue, okay, and this is set around the partition of Bengal. And how, in his own way, Tagore is rejecting the Vande Mataram model of nationalism, where he thinks it can lead to excesses. And he's asking a different question, not seeing the mother as nation as the mother, but the question, who will espouse the nation? I don't know if I'm making sense. Okay? And in his text, neither Nikhil nor Sandeep can espouse the nation. So the nation, as it were, and this is again very tantric, because in the Veera in the Tantras, regards the goddess as a spouse or as a partner, not as a mother. Okay, and the Bala regards her as a mother. So it's a very complex way of worshipping the mother. And a responsible citizen espouses the nation, not exalts her as the mother alone. And what kind of a mother, you know? What is a good enough mother? Okay, so when the child is very young, the mother indulges the child. When the child is a little grown up, they say, okay, go fend for yourself, you know? Let the child cry a bit. So we have to see the progression of the mother and the child. 70 years, do we still want to be infantilized, okay? And finally, in terms of my literary references, I'd like to refer to another celebrated writer from Bengal of the opposite, so to speak, ideological camp, Mahashweta Devi, who has this amazing story of Dolati, who is, actually an exploited woman, who has been forced to become a sex worker. And then when she dies of venereal disease, and her body falls covering a map of India that a leader has drawn in order to make a speech the next day. And then Mahashweta Devi in this text asks, her body is discovered the next morning, laid out on an outline map of India, which had been drawn in chalk by a local schoolmaster to celebrate India's Independence Day. And this is how Mahashweta Devi concludes the story, filling the entire Indian peninsula from the oceans to the Himalayas. Here lies bounded labor, spread-eagled, Kamya Hor Dolati Nagesia's tormented corpse, putrefied with venereal disease, having vomited up all the blood in its desiccated lungs. Today, on the 15th of August, Dolati has left no room at all in the India of people like Mohan for planting the standard of the independence flag. What will Mohan do now? Dolati is all over India. So it's very interesting how the idea of Mother India was invoked also to hold our own leaders and politicians of independent India to account. So you see the transition, the idea of Mother India, Bharat Mata, Bharat Shakti, Bhavani Bharati, invoked to drive out the British and then hold the leaders of independent India to account on behalf of the dispossessed, whom they did not serve, those who did not get Swaraj. Do you get my point? So it's a very powerful goddess. And now let us look at some of these pictures, okay? And see. So this, as I've said, is a picture. Okay, one second. Maybe I'll use the pointer. Go to the first picture. Thank you. So this is the picture of Mother India with, see these icons, Gandhi, Patel, Nehru, and Bose. So one of the amazing things, and see the cartography, as I said, it's always superimposed on Akhanda Bharat, right? South Asia, the flag, and see the different things she has in her arms, book, trident, etc. So this is a unique kind of goddess, okay? Anyhow, next. Now, I disagree with Sumati Ramaswamy because I believe that Mother India is another version, okay, of the Akhanda Purusha, the cosmic person celebrated in the Vedas and the Upanishads. This cosmic being is the bridge between all the three worlds, okay? And please understand that this is a process of remembering the dismembered. See, member means how many members, okay? Member also means parts of a body. So when you look at the myth of the Shakti Peets, you know, I call it a very powerful myth of the dismembering of the mother goddess, and the parts of the body fall all over India, okay? So dismembering is a creation myth. How is the world created? That cosmic unbroken unity breaks itself up into individuality. That's how there are so many people in this room, individuality. And once you're broken apart, you know, once, bhakti and vibhakti, you're always trying to reunite. So most of Indian art is a celebration of this attempt to reunite, which means once you bring all the parts together, you recreate the whole. I don't know if I'm making sense. But so here's an image of Vishnu as Purusha, the cosmic person, okay? Now, this is the image that is constantly replicated in India in most Indian iconic representations. And even the Indian temple is an attempt to capture, represent, and reproduce this unbroken, Purusha, the cosmic being, you know. So I've got something. This is, the Vishwarupa. So the Vishwarupa Darshana in Gita is nothing but a re-inscription of the old hymn of Purusha Sukta. Okay, next please. And here are some more depictions. And there are Shaivite depictions, there are Vaishnavite depictions, and the being with hundreds of heads, hundreds of arms and legs, this cosmic totality. Here's another one. So whether it is a male figure, a female figure, a Shaivite figure, a Vaishnavite figure, a Buddha figure, or a Jain figure, they are all similar images of this grand unbroken unity. Next please. And I would say that the Tirthankars are also these grand, you see Bahubali, these huge images which traverse the three worlds, okay, which connect the three worlds. Here's another depiction, next please. This is a Jain image. So if you see the top, these are the worlds of the higher worlds where people enjoy bliss. These are the lower worlds where you go when you perform very bad deeds. And this little area is where, you can be reborn in an evolutionary body, where through your good deeds, you can rise and become greater than the gods themselves. If you look at the Jaina and the Buddha traditions, they believe that, the Tirthankar or the Arihant who has defeated all the internal enemies can become greater than a god, okay? So it's very interesting, this worldly evolutionary system. Next, please. Now, this is one of the earliest paintings of Bharat Mata by Abhinandranath. And you can see it's a very saumya, a very benign kind of picture with the different things in her hands, the book, the grass, because this is grain. She's very bountiful, okay? But she's dressed in saffron, okay? And the vastra and the mala, japamala. Again, it's cartographic. She's standing on a piece of earth. These are the lotuses at her feet. Next, please. Now you can see Ravi Varma. Now slowly, you know, the image is getting, even now, very friendly, very benign, but now there's a lion, okay? So slowly it's getting, you know, more and more revolutionary. Evolutionary and revolutionary as you proceed. The flag, the mountains at the back, the Himalayas, this is the cartographic imaginary. And the lion, which is again from the Durga. Next, please. Here's another image, like the skull, you know, necklace of skulls, the garland of skulls. You will see these skulls, and you know, we can't blow it up, but these are all the famous nationalist leaders, you know, Dadabhai Navroji, Lokmanya Tilak, all these people adorn her neck, in her necklace, and now she has a trident, she has a sword in her hand. So you can see, and who is this? This is Annie Besant, okay? She's not even an Indian. She's an Irish woman, as you know, who participated in the Home Rule movement. This is at the time of the Home Rule movement, okay? So you can see how Annie Besant is also a part of Mother India and her Matriots, as I call them. And here's the map of India, always in the background, okay? Next, please. Which one? Move back, the one before that? Yeah, so, as I said, this was at the around the 1920s, a little bit before that, during the Home Rule movement. And this is Annie Besant, as I said. So these are all pictures from various popular presses. Lithography had just been invented, and Indians really took to it. And we made calendars from these images. They were circulated widely and sold. And today they're collector's items, because visual history has now become very, very important for us to understand ourselves. Okay, next, please. Here's another image of Mother India. And here's the British King Emperor honoring Mother India. And see, Lokmanya Tilak, all the great sons and daughters of India are ranged all around her. Again, there is a cartographic imagination around India. Next, please. This is a Tamil journal. And you can see the idea of India as Mother Goddess was always meant to be inclusive. If you see Bhavani Bharati, this poem by Sri Aurobindo, he addresses the different communities, you know, and the different religious groups, saying, the mother wants all of you. Now, you might say that it is inclusive, and yet it is predominantly a Hindu system of imagining the mother as goddess, and then we'll have to accept that. But it is not meant to exclude. All of them are her children. If you read Tagore's Gora, Mother India there is represented by Annapurna, you know. And Gora, of course, is not even Indian. He's the most militant of the Hindus in the text. He's an Irish foundling, a baby found, because the mother delivers him in the home of the zamindar and dies. And then the zamindar family raises this child as their own. He becomes Gora. And Binoy and Sucharita are the Brahmos. Annapurna is the mother of everybody. Okay, next, please. So just go back for a second, please. So you can see Muslims, people with shikhars, all kinds of people, padres, everybody is bowing to Mother India. Okay, and again, mountains, ocean, territory. So Mother India, next, please, will always be connected with territory. Now, here is where you see how the diaspora plays such an important role in the imagining of Mother India. So this Vande Mataram is printed abroad, okay, in Munich. There were people like Bhikaji Kama, Madame Bhikaji Kama, who unfurled the Indian flag for the first time abroad. So I wanted to say that the mother as goddess caught on and spread as wildfire in diasporic Indian communities, both revolutionary and pacifist, all over the world. In England, of course, there was a very big community. There was India House run by Shyamji Krishna Varma, Savarkar was there. There's a whole history of these groups. So this was the European group, and you see with the sword and again the territory. Next, please. The United States of India. No prizes for guessing. This is from San Francisco. There were revolutionary groups there as well. This is the 1920s. This is the Gadar group in America, where they were also championing the cause of Mother India and then aligning it with something that would resonate in the US, you know, the idea of the United States, right? And actually, America was very open and friendly to Indian nationalists till it joined the war and so on and so forth and joined the British efforts till the Second World War. Next, please. Yeah. So now you can see these images are now coming closer to how the RSS and other groups like the Hindu Mahasabha started conceptualizing Mother India. The RSS was, of course, founded in 1925. By Dr. Keshav Baliram Hedgewar, you can see the roaring lion, though the figure is still extremely benign, not many armed, but carrying the saffron flag, the Bhagwa Jhanda, with Om there and the planets, right. So the argument, next please, that I've been making is just as the cosmic person, right, or Purusha is meant to bridge all the worlds, the concept of Mother India as nation, as goddess, was also a deeply spiritual idea to awaken consciousness, okay? It was not just about cultural, territorial, or political nationalism, okay? Now, you can see how popular the idea of our Hindu Devi has become. Because the Ahmedabad textile mills is using these ideas to sell their products, you know. Agents, you can see here, Narayan Lal and so forth, Jeevan Lal. So the pictures of Mother India as goddess now begin to proliferate and they are used, you know, for commercial purposes and, you know, to sell hair oil or, you know, textiles, and they become very popular all over India. That's my point. And you can see, again, the flag, but, you know, no weapons here, because I think the textile mills don't want to get into any controversy. They don't want to offend the British authorities. Okay, next. Now, this is a map of the Shakti Peets. Okay, of the 51 body parts of the mother sliced from her dead body by Vishnu, who was following Shiva. That's the story. But you can see, again, that's why I disagree a little bit with Sumati Ramaswamy, because the remembering of the dismembered goddess, okay, produces Bhavani Bharati. That's my point. So she thinks that it's completely new. But I argue that there's actually always the capacity to bring this goddess back to life. Because when the devotee, when the Shakta goes to all these peaks in his or her life, then he would have physically recreated the body of the mother goddess. I hope you understand what I'm saying. The pilgrimage becomes a way of remembering in two senses of the word. Remembering means calling to mind, but remembering, meaning joining together and creating the Akriti of the goddess, okay? But please remember, this cartography, please, is modern. We didn't have this kind of map before the British came. Our maps were nothing like this. Okay, next. Where? Go back. Where is the cross? Oh, this is longitude and latitude. I wish I could interpret it in an ideological way. But I'll show you one where there's an actual cross, where there is a crucifixion also in the picture. I've brought that also for you. Yeah, Hinglaj Devi. There are many there in Afghanistan, Bangladesh. So the idea, you see, this modern India-Pakistan-Bangladesh division is a new one, okay? The cultural unity of India precedes that, okay, precedes the partition. Next, please. So, here are safety matches. You see what I'm trying to say? The images of the goddess now adorn all kinds of things, even humble safety matches. Adorn, I mean the Devi adorns even humble safety matches, but Trishul Dhari, and you see this is a kind of naive art, but at the same time it's very evocative, right? And so it's a collector's item now. Next, where? Go back, please. Yes, you see, this is the flag here. You see here? So, obviously, the flag is still in the process of being made. This is the complicated India of princely states and British, all amalgamated. But remember, it's for safety matches. It's not supposed to be accurate. You know, that's why I called it our own version of naive art, popular art. Okay, next, please. Now you see how the revolutionaries get incorporated into the grand narrative of India. So here is Bhagat Singh, who has offered his head, you know, like Chinmasta, you know, a blood oblation, okay, a blood offering to the mother goddess, and she's pleased with the offering, Trishul, book, and so forth, and see. So this, the nation, you know, you have to understand this, and Gandhi said it, not me. He says, the nation demands blood. Don't think nationalism is a tea party. Okay, if you want to be a great nation, you have to be willing to sacrifice to create that nation. Next, please. Again, now Jai Hind. And see, this is a calendar of 46-47 with Netaji here, okay? And Netaji is receiving the sword because he was in Kohima around that time, 45, okay? So he's receiving the sword from Mother India to liberate India. That is the idea here. Remember, Shivaji received a sword from Tulja Bhavani, okay, in his dream. So that's what I'm saying. This is not entirely an invention. It relies on an older cultural memory, which is re-invoked, okay, and for re-invoked and harnessed for an anti-imperialist mission. Next, please. We can move a bit fast now. Again, Netaji, and you see all the people who sacrifice for the mother. But see, the mother here is still in chains. So that's the whole point of invoking the goddess. And why is it matriotism? Because, you know, somehow it would seem, though I might be completely wrong, that Indians find it easier to sacrifice even their lives to protect the dignity and honor of their mother than their spouses. I may be wrong, but anyhow, it's a joke. Okay, next. So again, Netaji in the lap of Mother India. Gandhiji, this is a pieta figure, you know, like if you see in Western art, Christ and the Madonna. After Christ is crucified and brought down from the cross, his mother, Mary, takes him in his lap and sheds tears, okay? And it's a wonderful reversal here, because Gandhi is an old man here. So an old son of a young mother. Mother India is still young. Unlike Christ, where Madonna is obviously older, and Christ dies young, as you know. So you can see in the iconic and visual how the different, cultural interpenetration is taking place. Okay, next. The goddess and the nation. Here's another version of that image. You know, this is the Duke University Press cover. And the first slide I showed you was from, that was the Duke University Press. No, this is the Duke University Press cover. 2010, and the one I showed you was Zuban Press, from India 2014. Next, please. So again, you see these amazing, the splendor that is India, and here are all the great, the rishis, Nanak, Guru Nanak, Sri Ramakrishna, Gandhi, all of them, the Sai Baba, all the great sons, Mahatmas who make up India as a sacred land, okay? And they're all giving their strength, all the three Acharyas, Shankara, Ramanuja and Madhava, all giving their strength for this reawakening of Mother India, the great Indian Renaissance that is to come, okay? What Bankim imagined, that after this terrible fall during colonialism, there'll be another resplendent era of Mother India. Next, please. Here again, you see the garland of skulls, Lala Lajpat Rai, Nehru, Tilak, Shivaji is also here, the goddess, the flag, the Trishul, and then the map, the cartography. Next, please. This is a painting called Mother India by Amrita Shergill. And this is the interesting counterpoint that I was trying to tell you, the realistic counterpoint to the mythic imagination of the mother. And that's the line that goes to Mahashweta's story, Adolati, that I mentioned to you, where, Matriots are trying to say, the people in this country, are really, this is your Mother India, very static, the kind of vacant look in the eyes, the passivity, the inaction and so forth, it's a very interesting counterpoint to the, inspiring and rousing images that we see. Next, please. So here you see, once again, Bharat Mata and this resplendent goddess, now we are again going into the iconic representation, the different images of the goddess. Next, please, including those of the RSS. Now here, this you see the old Gandhi Charkha here, the Charkha flag before the lion and the. The gada here, not the trishul. Trishul is a little bit there, but here's the gada. But still, not ferocious, benign. Even the lion is very benign, as you can see. Next, please. This is a very interesting picture of Bharat Mata. This is the British crown. You can see the crown has fallen. Here is the new standard, the Ashokan lion. Standard of Mother India as independent. Here's the flag. So this happens around independence, okay? So the British crown has fallen, right? And this is our emblem of independent India. And here is Bharat Mata. Next. Again, this is, I think, after independence. You see Sarojini Naidu, Maulana Azad, everybody, Khan Abdul Ghaffar Khan, the millions of Indians, who are now independent. Next. This is the RSS picture printed by Karnataka Rashtriya Swayamsevak Sangh, 1990. It's a beautiful image, as you can see, with the lion and the goddess and the flag. Next, please. This is, of course, Mehboob's Mother India, music by Naushad, right? So I was trying to say that the idea of Mother India was not only Hindu. Many people participated in it. And here you see, this is a post-independence film, which I was trying to point out, that the state is held accountable by the sufferings of ordinary Indians. Here, Mother India has to plow the field herself. She's so poor, so indebted. There are no bullocks. She herself has to, plow the field. And it's a challenge, as it were, to the state to say, what have you done? You haven't kept your promises of Swaraj. Next. Again, here's a picture of Mother India as a goddess Again, a post-independence Sudarshan Chakra, Trishul, many-armed goddess, flowers, fruits. Next. Now, here you see, Indira Gandhi is also linked with Mother India. Two lions, okay? Sword, Trishul, today's divisive politics has forgotten that she was also seen as a form of Durga when she split Pakistan and helped to liberate Bangladesh. Okay, next please. Here is Rajiv Gandhi, and this is a very interesting election poster type of Mother India, where here is Mother India holding the mother, that is Indira Gandhi's body, riddled with bullets. And here is Rajiv Gandhi, you know, almost encashing that, making political capital of that tragedy in order to appeal for votes. And you can see the flag. Here's a Bhagwa Jhanda, for example, and different pictorial and cartographic representations of Mother India. Next, please. So Vande Mataram, you know, here is another kind of RSS image of India as goddess, Mother India as goddess. Next, please. Now, this is MF Hussain, obviously many people criticized him this is the 50th year celebration of India, and he was criticized for showing Indian goddesses in the nude. I'm not sure that alone is objectionable. Many Indian goddesses are nude, right? But here Mother India is clothed a little bit at least. He painted a number of these Mother India type of paintings. And of course, he's, Muslim. So the idea of Mother India was inspiring to people of many, many communities. That's my point, as goddess. Next, please. So Abhyudaya. Now here is, here's the painting. Somebody was asking about the cross. So here is the peasant crucified, and here's the British exploiting the poor peasant of India. And you can see how the crucifixion of the Indian peasant and all the vultures around the starvation of India is also used in the pictorial representation of Mother India. Next, please. There is a cartographic imagination. There's Bharat Mata and all put there, and there is the peasant being crucified. I think this goes back to the Bengal famine of that kind of period. Let me see. Cartographic something. I can't read it properly here. This is 1931 from the British Library. But these are, I think, left-wing periodicals showing starving peasants and all that. But I can't be sure. I can't read these texts very clearly because the images are very indistinct. Okay, next please. I have the printed version. So these are, if you can you click on that? Do you have internet? I just wanted to show you, there are many, free. These are free pictures available on Google, if you want to look and explore this theme further. And as we are talking, you can also just scroll down a bit. Please scroll down a bit, and thank you. And then you can also scroll for pictures of the Bengal famine while we are taking questions. So thank you so much. Thank you for your attention. Thank you.
Yeah. Yes. This is a very enthralling lecture. And my question is, as you said, the concept of Mother India was accepted, by all the communities. There was no issue at all. But the paradox was that Vande Mataram did not become our national anthem, for the very same reason that it was opposed by the, the significant minority community at that time. And even though it became a national song, the third and fourth paragraph was excluded. So do you think it was really the first failure for our nation in terms of secularism, because in 1990s, A.R. Rahman again, you know, made it so famous, you know, Vande Mataram. Do you think that it was again a failure of our nation in terms of secularism, that it didn't become our national anthem, which it should have rightly become, you know, taken it rightly?
Ananta Narayanji, thank you so much. That's a very nice question. I'm glad you mentioned A.R. Rahman Ma Tujhko Salaam, where he tried to tell, you know, people in India that it's not necessarily kufr to respect your mother, you know, that it's not necessarily image worship and so forth. And I'm also glad that you brought up this notion of the national anthem, because don't forget that the national anthem of Bangladesh, which is a Muslim country by and large, and it was officially an Islamic country for a very, very long time, probably still is, I'm not sure, is Amar Sonal Bangla by Rabindranath Tagore, which is again a cartographic invocation of Bengal as the mother. And in that sense, it would attract the same objections as Vande Mataram. The Vande Mataram is more militant, no doubt. This is more komal, you know, this Amar Sonal. But again, it invokes a shape, a cartographic imagination, a form, and those who do not like the worship of form should object even to that. So I'm saying there are contradictions. In other words, the objection, now to answer your question precisely, the objections to Vande Mataram are less theological than ideological. You know, it was sung even by Tagore. The full song was sung. It was sung fully. And then the Muslim League and other people started creating a propaganda against it. And then the Congress, even Gandhi spoke in favor of it. And then they came up with a Vaya Media, which is only the first two verses will be sung. And of course that was appeasement, because at that time they wanted a united India. They wanted to take everybody along. And gradually they started breaking apart that dream of the united India. And I've written a book, as you know, on the last days of Gandhi and how sad he was, you know, that this, despite, you know, agreeing and, you know, to almost everything that the other side wanted, partition still happened. So the failure of the project of a united India, in it lay the seeds of majoritarian nationalism in India. I'm saying this is as much a picture of Mother India as any, and it really in some ways matches you know, the image of Kali in Anandamath. So I'm saying that why is this idea of Mother India so powerful? Because, you know, it shows exactly what happened to this country under foreign domination and rule for such a long time. And so it was not an accidental, you might say, reinvention of the goddess as nation in the 19th century. It had a very specific purpose, okay? It was to bind a nation of disparate people, possibly even desperate, but, you know, together, and to unite them, and for uniting diverse people, a symbolic entity was required where everyone could come together, a focal point. And that focal point became the idea of the nation as goddess. That's the point. Whereas the British view of India, which is not to be easily dismissed, because many people in India still believe it, is that India is not a nation, because a nation means one community. You know, Benedict Anderson wrote a book called Imagined Communities. So European notions of nation are based on either one language or one religion or one ethnicity on the one hand, or some kind of civic contract. And the Indian notion of a nation is very different, because nobody is asked to completely sort of renounce or merge that diversity in India. It's not melting bowl, okay? It's not that you come from somewhere and everybody becomes the same. Nor is it a salad bowl. It's something very different. That's my point. So So the British said it's easy to rule these guys because they're not a nation, they're not one people. And they always saw India right from the early times. The first important history that they wrote was by James Mill, who never came to India but wrote this huge book, several volumes of it. And they didn't see us as one people in that modern sense. And so, when the nationalists in the 19th century said that we need a counter-narrative, they found that the counter-narrative was not possible without creating that focal point to unite everybody, which became the goddess's nation. I hope I'm making my point. Yes?
My question is regarding evolution of the concept of Mother India. Like post-State Recognition Commission, post-SRC, State Recognition Commission, and division of India into many states, there came like, when subnationalism was much more higher, there came many concepts of mothers, different mothers across India, like Telugu Thalli, for example, or Maratha, Tamil mother, or across various states. So after that, the concept of Mother India, did it strengthened or weak or weakened, or how it evolved with that changes that happened in India's political structure and everything?
That's such a good question, actually, because that slide that I showed you from the Tamil periodical says Thai, Tamil Thai. So Sumathi Ramaswamy has another book on Tamil, I mean the languages of mother. Now, you know, the question of subnationalism is a very, very important question, because see, there are two ideas, or there are at least two ways of looking at nationalism. Like nationalism is something that binds, right? Which is based on what is common. Like what is common to say someone from Kerala and from Bengal, you know? Certainly, that's one thing that's common, but that link is withering away because it's declining in both. Just how it happened. But so, you see, that's why Benedict Anderson calls it imagined community, because your earlier notion of a primordial community is your family, your village, people you encounter every day, that's your community. But suddenly, because of the print media, you know, somebody in Thiruvananthapuram could read about something happening in Kolkata and say, you know what, this is my problem too. And you create this binding force. That's why he calls it an imagined community. Don't think imagine means unreal. Imagination is very real, by the way. Okay, as you all know, virtual reality is very real. Anyhow, but to answer your question, so nationalism can be seen as something that binds or brings together diverse people who are intrinsically have very little in common. Or it can be something that divides. In other words, if you think about Pakistani nationalism, it's based on incompatibility, by saying, look, not that I can live with you, that we are the same, I can't live with you. So sometimes subnationalisms can take that hue, but subnationalisms can also be marsupials. So you have the mother kangaroo, and then the baby kangaroo is in the pouch. The baby kangaroo is not saying, I can't live with you. So in a sense, apart from just a small part of a very virulent phase when I think some of the parties here burned the flag and all, subnationalisms in India are marsupial. Okay, they're not the other kind where, because most of these groups realize that staying with India has more advantages. Something you have to think about deeply.
Sir, you said like there was a critical some secular view or idolatry view.
Yeah.
Where was the change actually came about, where the flag changed its color? And was it accepted by both of these, or these both people rejected the idea of changing the color of the flag? So it might have been progressional in the years also, by the way.
Okay, see, by the way, when I mentioned critical idolatry, I was quoting Mitchell, a critic, a theorist of visual arts, okay? So please understand, critical idolatry means that idolatry means the love or the worship of idols. So by and large, Indians are idolaters, by and large. You know, even, I mean, Buddhists, Jains, they build huge icons, idols, images. We like images, you please understand what I'm saying. And even the Mughals had lots of artists they patronized. So we are an image-making, image-worshipping, image-adoring culture. So critical idolatry means, critical simply means you have to be rational, you have to question. That is the way to look at pictures, not iconoclasm. Iconoclasm means images are bad. It's image or icon-phobic societies are like that. They're not critical, but they are image-hating and image-breaking. So basically, Mitchell is saying, when you're trying to do visual history, you know, see if you can adore the image. And I think that a little bit of respect, a little bit of Shraddha will help us enjoy and understand better. That's the idea. That has nothing to do with the color of the flag, okay? Now, the color of the flag and the shape of the flag, how the flag was, whether it had an Ashok Chakra, Charkha, was it a Bhagwa Jhanda, that was a part of the ideological debates that were happening around Indian nationalism. So, you know, the Hindu nationalists, they wanted the saffron flag, and they said, this is our natural flag, and it's always been like that. The Congress, which was a composite party, they wanted to appeal to all sections, so they had, saffron, green and white. You see, the Muslim League flag is almost entirely green. The crescent is white. So please see that the flags are a part of another debate, another, you might say, iconographic struggle between the competing ideologies and the sickle and the hammer is the leftist flag. So, to answer your question, the freedom movement in India, the anti-imperialist period, was characterized by a competition between many different ideas of India and many different ideologies to make their respective ideas of India come true. And you have known, because of history, which idea prevailed at that time. Okay?
A small observation and also a question. So, is the Ma Bharati and Bhumata the same thing? The observation I want to make is around 700 AD, we had Varaha Avatara carrying the woman, the Bhumata in the form of a woman. Slowly, after establishing or acknowledging that the earth was in the form of a globe, we see Varaha Avatara carrying a globe. Yes. Yes. So that doesn't mean, see, the same way when the author tells that the concept of Mother India wasn't there because there was no cartography, might not be true because, see, just like before we didn't know that earth was a sphere, we had Bhumata sitting on Varaha. So it could have been different. Without a map, they would have still been Ma Bharati. So my question is Bhuma, Bhudevi and Ma Bharati the same thing for Hindu or the Indian this thing, the
context? So see, this is the point that I don't think we need to be invested in constantly projecting things at the back, you know, because newness also enters the world, okay? So I don't think that you're less, loving of Indian culture, less matriotic by thinking that, you know what, this is a new idea. You don't have to say, oh, this always existed. You know, Rashtravad, Vedon, Jitna Purana hai. You know, this kind of thinking has its own problems because you have to define what you're talking about. Right? So, yes, obviously, Bhu Devi, Shri Devi, they all become, you know, Bharat Mata. They contribute. But there is never this kind of proliferation of images till the late 19th century. You know, show me any such image of Bharat Mata before, then I'll believe, where is the evidence? Whereas I can show you thousands of images of different Devis. There are hundreds of devis that have been portrayed before Bharat Mata, before 1860s. Okay? But none of them is quite like this. That's my point. And the reason that it's not the same is, as I told you, because we didn't even know exactly the cartography at that time. And when you mention this Varaha avatar lifting up, that you have to actually see the actual image. You have to try to date it. All this becomes very complicated in India because we have 34 different calendars. Dating in India becomes very difficult. So either you say, look, dates are not that important. The specificities of geography are not that important, but the idea is important. Okay, you can say that, and that's how most of India functioned. Or you want to map the critical historical method onto something that was in the past, which is more complicated. I don't know if you understand what I'm saying. That is also a trap. Yeah? I think you're getting my point. It's a subtle point. You see, it is, if you want to prove yourself by somebody else's definition, you're falling into a different kind of trap. So please think about this and lifting up, the Varaha avatar and all. So everything was feminized. Not everything, but rivers were feminized. Bhudevi was feminized. Prithvi was feminized. Prakriti was feminized. So there was always goddess producing mechanisms. But this goddess, Bharat Mata, in this particular iconographic representation, with these elements around her, that starts up only in the 19th century. And the first temple, of course, is built in the 30s in Banaras Hindu University, in 34, the first Bharat Mata temple.
Due to time constraints, we'll take the last question.
Okay. This lady has a question. So maybe we can have two quick questions.
Okay.
Go ahead. I saw her hand first. Go ahead.
Thank you so much, sir. Actually, I wanted to ask, there was a suffering during Mughal era also. There was a suffering during British era. So why this term, Mother India, became powerful in British era, not in Mughal era?
See, this is such a good question because, if you, there is a theory that this modern form of nationalism, which resulted in the nation state that is India, was not present till the 19th century. It was a product of an Indian awakening that took place under the umbrella of British imperialism. And your question is actually pointing in the direction that perhaps this theory is true. Because even though there was a notion of Hindavi Rashtra, even the Vijayanagar Empire had a notion of some sort of Hindu Rashtra to oppose this domination of India. And so these ideas of freedom from foreign domination, though they were present, they had not crystallized to create, a robust and complete ideology during those times. Because this notion of nationalism was not quite present at that time. In a decentralized polity where the peasants were taxed, whoever ruled, this idea of having, a nation state based on a particular, belief system, even during the Mughal kingdom was not so powerful. And that's why there was no unity. For example, if we all know how many times Ghazni destroyed Somnath, obviously he had to pass through all those kingdoms, right? So he must have made some deal with them that just let me go, I'm not going to destroy you guys. So today you can't pass through that easily to cross the border and come all the way, to Chennai from the Khyber Pass may not be that easy today. But in those days there were these smaller kingdoms, even you saw the Rajputs could not have unity, Rana Sangha tried. So that unity could only come this Punjab is in Gujarat, etc. And the similar thing is in Shrabindo's poem. That is something new. The United States of India. So, again, I call it incipient nationalism. A vestigial Shaktism, like that. But not what we see today. So that's right. In other words, my position is in between the two extremes. One which says we were always a nation. One which says that we just became a nation. I see a continuity, okay, which is before this time. And yet I see a newness in what happened after the 19th century. And I think this nuanced position has greater foundation in fact and evidence. The other positions are more ideological. I mean, they are a product of a political compulsion. One, to divide India by saying it's an invention. And I always say that if Mother India is an invention, don't forget Dravidianism is also an invention. You know, it's even a later invention. So to think that, you know, something, you know, becomes false because it's invented. No. You see, IITs are an invention. Somebody established them. There was a Nyas. There was a process. There was a parliamentary act. Then they created systems. So institution building has mechanisms. You know, it is a rule-bound thing. Creation of goddesses is rule-bound. That's my point. And new goddesses can be produced, you know, for a particular purpose. And this is what happened in the 19th century. So even Indian nationalism, Swaraj, they go back. Swaraj Parampara is very old. But it is in the 19th century that it acquires a different form, a different shape. That's why I said my position is between these two extremes. Okay? Thank you. Last question.
Yeah, my question is regarding the dominance of Shaktism primarily in the East, so specifically in Bengal, which where it became predominant after the 17th century. So by the 19th century, it's already there, even though Gauri Vaishnavism is also there. But like when the Swaraj movement is happening, the people from Anglo Student Samitis or even Tagore personally, but the movement itself is celebrating, like it's uniting around the image of Kali. They're worshipping Kali as a symbol of Bengal. So how Shaktism or the worship of Shaktism in Bengal translates into secularized mother goddess or goddess Bengal, as also in Bankim's song, which is primarily about Bengal. So how does that translate into pan-India phenomena, given that, say, Gujarat, Rajasthan, UP, Vaishnavism, which is still dominant, not Shaktism. So how does it emotionally relate, or how do people emotionally relate to Shaktism at that level? How does Mother India, instead of a Vaishnavic form, how does the Shakta form become dominant as a symbol?
Sure, but as I showed you in that map of the Shakti Pithas, Shaktism is all over India. And, you know, it's very interesting if you, you know, see the three parts of India where the revolutionaries, you know, against the British Empire come from. They are Bengal, Punjab and Maharashtra. And in each of these, there is a goddess worship. So there's Chandi there, Chandigarh. And Guru Gobind Singh was a great worshipper of Chandi. In Bengal, you already know, you've said it. And in Maharashtra, Tulja Bhavani. So, you know, Balwant Phadke and all these people, the first revolutionaries came from Maharashtra before it caught fire in Bengal. And don't forget that when Sri Aurobindo was writing these Bhavani Bharati and writing this, Bhavani Mandir, he was in Baroda and he had gone to the banks of Narmada, and Baroda was ruled by the Gaikwads. And he was deeply influenced by Maratha history and the idea of Shivaji and receiving the sword, So Bhavani Bharati and Bhavani Mandir in Sri Aurobindo is directly derived in a sense from the Tulja Bhavani of Shivaji. So it is not that Shaktism is purely an Eastern phenomenon. Though there, you know, you might say the Tantric traditions became very powerful in the East. But, you know, mother worship, look at Tamil Nadu, look at Meenakshi Amman, there's a full of mother goddesses, you see. So, and there is a deeper reason for this, because as I said, that Akhanda Purusha, whose sacrifice creates the universe, that has the counterpoint in the dismembering of the mother. So, you see, these rituals of remembrance are to take us back through this yagnik or puja or some other methodology to the initial wholeness. In other words, the whole purpose of Hindu eschatology is to take us back to the primeval oneness, unity, fullness, purnata, abundance, from which we emerged as separate entities. So all these methodologies are to reconnect with that fullness. And certainly the figure, the grand figure of Mother India, and don't forget that Bha is to shine, the Bhaswat, you see, the Prabha, you know, of Mother India was meant, if you read Sri Aurobindo and all these people, it's not just for India that Mother India rises. So India stands for the for a consciousness revolution, you know, which should affect all of humankind, because humanity is itself in a state of crisis. And the crisis is of rationality, which is also a crisis of technology, climate, economics. And pure rationality, pure science of the Western post-enlightenment kind, that does not give us the holism of the wisdom that is required, you know, to save ourselves from self-destruction. And the rising of Bhavani Bharati is, you know, that Chidagni Kunda Sambhuta, you see. It is for that Devakarya. And the Devakarya is for all of humanity. This is the presumption, if you read some of even Sri Aurobindo's writings. I think on that note we can end. Thank you so much. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Audience are requested to stay back for national anthem and photo session with our speaker. May I request Professor Ramasankar Verma, sir, our beloved faculty advisor, to come up on the stage and present Ma Durga as a token of respect and gratitude to the speaker.
We should take a picture now with all the fruit offerings there. So this will be really like Mother India. Sukhalam, you know. One more. Idhar aaiye.
Kashyapji to propose the vote of thanks.
And before that, I think we were very delighted and very, very happy that I have learned something about Mother India, and I'm sure you guys also have learned. And such a scholarly presentation by Dr. Paranjpe, I think, is very nice.
Thank you.
We consider ourselves to be blessed to have Professor Makarand Paranjape as the speaker of third Bankim Chandra Chattopadhyaya Memorial Lecture. The session was really enlightening to all of us, and I thank you once more for allocating time for us during your busy schedule. And on this auspicious day of Festival of Democracy in Chennai, it's very great to have a session that reminds us what Bharat Mata, as we call, is, and how, as matriots, how we should act ourselves to protect her pride and our ancestors' pride. And myself, Kashyap, on the behalf of Vande Mataram family, thank all of you for your selfless support and love for the last 4 years. And once again, I thank you, all of you. Our alumni are there, our students are here, and the light and sound people, the videography people, for your unconditional love and support. Thank you. Thank you all.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, Kashyap ji. Now I once again invite Srinivas ji for the national anthem. Request you all to sing.
जनगणमन अधिनायक जय हे भारत भाग्य विधाता पंजाब सिंधु गुजरात मराठा द्राविड उत्कल बंगा विंध्य हिमाचल यमुना गंगा उच्चल जलधि तरंगा तव शुभ नामे जागे तव शुभ आशीष मांगे गाहे तव जय गाता जनगण मंगलदायक जय हे भारत भाग्य विधाता जय हे जय हे जय हे जय 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 हे
जय
भारत माता की
जय।